There we go. Okay. Yep. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the next seminar. So today we've got Yevgeny Stadnik, who is one of our new Dukra fellows here at the University of Sydney. So some people will know Yevgeny because he originally did his PhD right here in Sydney at over at UNSW with Victor Flambau. He then moved to postdocs in Mainz and Tokyo IPMU, where he was a cavity fellow, before moving very recently to his current position here with us at Sydney. So Yevgeny is a well-known expert in low energy particle physics, phenomenology and theory and experiment. And he's particularly an expert in searches for dark matter at very, very low masses, which is what he's going to tell us about today. So thanks, Yevgeny, for agreeing to give the seminar, and I'll pass it over to you.
So first of all, thank you very much for the invitation to present this talk to you today. The quality of my voice, unfortunately, is not very good today, but I'll try my best to at least be understandable. So essentially, I'd like to give you a brief overview of some of the ways that we can look for ultra-low-mass scalar dark matter by using a variety of precision low-energy experiments. The motivation for trying to understand the identity and microscopic properties of dark matter essentially comes about from a collection of astrophysical and cosmological data, which suggests that there is about five times more dark matter in the universe than the ordinary visible matter around us. And what we understand from the astrophysical evidence is that the majority of the dark matter, a substantial fraction of the dark matter resides in the halos of the galaxies. And so we see that we have these spheroidal halos. Now, from the point of view of laboratory experiments, there are two important features of the dark matter to take into consideration. The first is that in the vicinity of the solar system, we know that the average energy density of dark matter should be about half a proton rest mass per cubic centimeter. We understand that this is a very small density compared with the usual matter-based densities that we come across in a terrestrial environment. But this is also quite a small density compared with even some of the best vacuum systems that we can generate on Earth ourselves. And the smallness of this density is, in fact, one of the reasons why it's very challenging to see the direct effects of dark matter in a purely laboratory setting. The other important feature of the dark matter is that in the vicinity of the solar system, we understand that its root mean squared speed should be about 300 kilometers a second. And this number essentially comes about, this number essentially comes about from the requirement that the dark matter should neither escape from the gravitational well of the galaxy, and nor should the dark matter collapse to the center of the galaxy, at least on a cosmologically large timescale. So 300 kilometers a second is about 1/1000th of the speed of light. And this implies that the galactic dark matter is a non-relativistic form of matter. And in fact, the highly non-relativistic nature of the galactic dark matter has a number of important consequences for how we try to devise essentially any type of direct detection experiment in the laboratory. And we'll see the reasons for this as we proceed throughout the talk. So over the past several decades, the majority of experimental efforts in terms of direct searches for dark matter particles have tended to focus on so-called weakly interacting massive particles, or WIMPs for short. So their canonical mass range is about the rest mass of a proton, up to about 10 times the Higgs boson mass. So this is a relatively well-known and understood range of masses, at least from the point of view of the standard model of particle physics. However, there's been no strong experimental evidence for these types of particles. And so over the past decade or so, there's been growing interest in terms of searching for alternatives to the WIMP. And one of these interesting possibilities, which has gained significant traction, particularly over the past decade, is the possibility that the dark matter may consist of bosonic particles with extremely small masses. So these bosonic particles could live in the green range over here. And we see that this green range is very complementary to the more familiar range of masses in orange here. In fact, the complementarity of the mass ranges necessitates the use of conceptually very different types of approaches when it comes to these two different types of dark matter. And I'll explain just how big these differences are very shortly. So in this talk, I'd like to focus on scalar dark matter. So this is basically a form of dark matter which is described by a spinless field. And the simplest type of spinless field that we can have would have a single degree of freedom. So the field is described by a real field. So if these low mass spinless particles were produced in the early universe, they can subsequently form a coherently oscillating classical field phi. And so we see that this field is essentially characterized by two parameters. One of the parameters that we see here is the angular frequency of the oscillations. And this is governed approximately by the rest mass energy of the dark matter particle. And the second parameter here is the amplitude of the oscillations, phi zero. And we see that these oscillations take place about the minimum of this harmonic or quadratic potential. Now, as a result of the oscillations of this dark matter field, there is a certain energy density which is associated with the oscillations. And the time average energy density in this case is given as a function of the frequency and the amplitude of these oscillations. So what we see is that the dependence on these two parameters is precisely what we would have for the usual underdamped harmonic oscillator. Now, the reason why the oscillations of the dark matter field are expected to be coherent is that we understand that the galactic dark matter should be non-relativistic or cold. So this basically means that the kinetic energies carried by these dark matter particles are all going to be much smaller than the rest mass energy of the dark matter particle. So this basically means that the overall energies of these dark matter particles are all going to be very similar, and they're going to be given approximately by the rest mass energy of the dark matter particle. And because it's the energy which governs the frequency of the oscillations, all the different particles essentially contribute in a coherent way in this case. Now, the oscillations in this dark matter field are not perfectly coherent, however. In our local galactic region, where there is a local root mean square speed of about 300 kilometers a second, we expect there to be a finite spread in the kinetic energies carried by these dark matter particles at a level of about one part per million relative to the rest mass energy of the dark matter particle. And we can equivalently restate this as saying that we expect there to be a finite coherence time associated with the oscillations of this dark matter field. And the coherence time should be of the order of a million periods of oscillation in this case. So in simpler terms, what we basically expect then is that the oscillations of this dark matter field should be nearly monochromatic. And the quality factor which we will describe to these oscillations would be of the order of a million. And this is actually quite a good quality factor, even compared with some of the best or even better resonators that we can produce in laboratory ourselves. Another way to understand this issue of coherence is to essentially note that the oscillating dark matter field that we have here is basically an ensemble of a very large number of particles. So we can rewrite or decompose the overall wave function here as a linear superposition of the wave functions of all of these individual particles. So in each of these cosinusoidal terms, the argument essentially contains three factors. So first of all, there's the contribution which is associated with the rest mass energy of the dark matter particle. And then there's also a contribution which is associated with the non-relativistic energies of these dark matter particles. And finally, there is also a phase term, which is basically determined by the initial conditions, which in practical terms, when we do measurements, is basically determined by the moment at which we start our experiment or observations. Now, the important point to note here is that the particle velocities which enter into the kinetic energy term here, are expected to be randomly distributed quantities. In the simplest case of a standard halo model, this would be just a usual maximum Boltzmann type distribution. So if we perform measurements on a relatively short time scale, which is much less than the coherence time here, so remember that the coherence time is governed by the spread in the kinetic energies, which in the maximum Boltzmann distribution is related to the root mean square speed. On these short time scales, the contribution or the growth of these random phases due to the kinetic energy term all remain small compared with the dominant term from the rest mass energy term. In other words, they all remain much less than 2 pi. So on these relatively short time scales, what this implies is that the overall amplitude of the oscillating dark matter field and also the overall phase, which we've suppressed here, are both going to remain approximately constant in time. So on these relatively short time scales, what we would see is that the amplitude of the oscillations would remain approximately constant over time. However, if we continue to perform measurements on a time scale, which becomes, say, comparable to the coherence time or greater than the coherence time, then on those longer time scales, the amplitude of the oscillation will be expected to fluctuate over time in some sort of stochastic manner here. And this is a result of the now non-negligible contributions from the randomly accumulated kinetic energy terms in this case. So these amplitude fluctuations in the oscillating field would be expected to be governed by some underlying probability distribution function. And if we assume the simplest standard halo model, this would basically be a Rayleigh-type distribution like the curve in red here. And this can be understood, for example, by analogy with the usual chaotic Gaussian light sources in standard model physics. Now, on the other hand, in order to have a classical field, we need to have a large number of these low mass dark matter particles contained within a single de Broglie volume. And for the local galactic dark matter density, we can satisfy the classicality requirement, provided that the dark matter particle mass is less than about 1 eV or so. So in other words, we need to have dark matter particle masses, which are at least a million times lighter than the electron in this case. I'm terribly sorry. And so essentially what this means is that for this particular type of dark matter, we are going to be especially interested in this mass range from about 10 to minus 21 electron volts up to about 1 eV or so. So this upper mass cutoff of 1 eV simply corresponds to the requirement of classicality, just like what we had above here. However, if this dark matter field was not necessarily classical, then the dark matter particle mass could in principle be much larger than 1 eV. On the other hand, if these low mass dark matter particles are to saturate the observed dark matter abundance, then the particle mass cannot be arbitrarily large. The basic argument for this is that in the case of these low mass dark matter fields, we expect it to be a suppression information of structures on length scales below about the de Broglie wavelength of the dark matter field. So this can be understood through the essentially the wave uncertainty principle. And so in this case, the argument is that as the dark matter particle mass decreases, the de Broglie wavelength correspondingly increases, and eventually the de Broglie wavelength would become astronomically large, and at some point it will become too large, and we run into, for example, contradictions with the structures that we, for example, observe in Lyman alpha forests. There is also a related figure of merit for this low mass bound, which comes from a simple argument that the dark matter Broglie wavelength should fit inside the halo sizes of the smallest dwarf galaxies. And it also leads to a similar low mass figure of merit in this case. But essentially, what we see here is that for this particular type of dark matter, we can have a very broad range of possible dark matter particle masses. And so what this basically implies is that we can also have a similarly broad range of possible frequencies of oscillation. So these frequencies can lie anywhere from about, can span anywhere from about 100 nanohertz, where the period of oscillation is conveniently of the order of a month. All the frequencies can go all the way up to about 100 terahertz, which corresponds to the infrared region of the electromagnetic spectrum. So even though this is a very broad range of possible frequencies of oscillation spanning about 20 orders of magnitude, the fact that these frequencies are at the same time very sort of understandable from the point of view of everyday physical processes means we can actually try to devise experiments which may potentially cover sizable regions in this possible range of frequencies. Now, the way that we would go about looking for these low mass dark matter fields is, of course, going to be very different to how we go about searching for traditional dark matter candidates like WIMPs. In a traditional WIMP dark matter direct search, we look for particle-like signatures. So for example, if there's a flux of WIMP dark matter particles, these WIMP dark matter particles can scatter off atomic nuclei in a series of targets, for example. And as the WIMP dark matter particles scatter, they deposit energy onto the nucleus and cause a recoil. However, if the dark matter particle mass is very small, and of course, if the dark matter is also highly non-relativistic, then in this case, the maximum kinetic energies carried by these dark matter particles are going to be of the order of a microelectron volt. And a microelectron volt is many orders of magnitude smaller than the energy thresholds in these traditional WIMP detectors, which are typically of the order of, say, 100 electron volts to a kiloelectron volt. And so what this basically tells us is that in the case of these ultra-low mass particles, it's basically impossible to look for it's practically impossible to look for their particle-like signatures. What we can do, however, is take advantage of the very large number density associated with these low-mass dark matter particles. Essentially, note that we can have numerous particles acting collectively or coherently to give us essentially field-like behavior. And this is the realm of these rather novel wave-like signatures. Now, in the case of wave-like signatures, the specific effects that we could look for will depend importantly on the type of dark matter that we have, and also the signatures will depend on how these dark matter fields interact with ordinary matter fields. In this talk, I'd like to give just a single example, which is that the scalar dark matter fields may induce apparent variations in the fundamental constants. There are a number of ways in which this can be done. So one very simple toy model would essentially involve the interaction with oscillator scalar field phi with the electromagnetic field tensor F. So in this case, there would be apparent oscillations in the value of the electromagnetic phi structure constant, which is the parameter which governs the strength of the electromagnetic interactions in the standard model. And so in this case, we see that the oscillations in alpha would take place at a frequency which is governed by the mass of the dark matter particle. And we also see that the amplitude of the oscillations in alpha would be proportional to the scalar field amplitude in this case. And also the amplitude of the oscillations would be inversely proportional to the new physics energy scale, which appears in a denominator of our interaction. Besides the electromagnetic coupling, we can also consider other types of interactions, such as the linear interaction with oscillator scalar field phi with a standard model fermion. In this case, we'd expect there to be apparent oscillations in the values of the fermion masses. And the expression here is very similar to the one that we had above, except now the new physics energy scale can in principle be a difference, can principle be different from the first one. And the two energy scales need not necessarily be related to one another. Another interesting point to take into consideration is that in laboratory experiments, we have a situation where we know that the ordinary matter in the galaxy, such as the stars and our solar system, are observed to be orbiting about the galactic center. However, the galactic dark matter halo is understood to be essentially at rest in the galactic frame. And this means that we expect there to be some relative motion between the apparatus in the laboratory relative to this dark matter halo. So in the laboratory frame of reference, what this means is that the oscillating dark matter field here would also be furnished by this additional motional gradient term in red. So this is basically by analogy with, for example, standing waves. And in this case, if we take into consideration these linear phi interactions coupled together with these motional gradients, then we expect there to be forces exerted on test bodies in the laboratory as we move through this dark matter halo. Now, these forces have a number of interesting features. First of all, these forces would be oscillating in time. This is because the dark matter field here is an oscillating function of time. Additionally, these forces would be directed along the relative motion of the apparatus or test particle with respect to the dark matter halo. And also, we notice that these, we see that these interactions here did not explicitly coupled to the overall mass of a body. In other words, the interactions here are non-universal because they only couple to some specific energy or mass energy component of an atom. In the case of the electromagnetic coupling, for example, this would involve the coupling of the scalar field to the the Coulomb binding energy of an atom or nucleus. Whereas in the case of the fermion coupling, this could be, for example, the electron mass contribution of an atom. And because of this non-universal nature of the interactions, we expect these forces to therefore violate the equivalence principle. And this is actually a very nice feature of these types of forces because it allows us to distinguish these forces from, for example, the usual gravitational effects, which are universal in nature and don't distinguish between different types of atoms or materials. Apart from these linear phi interactions, it's also possible to have analogous phi squared interactions. So these phi squared interactions, for example, can arise in models with an underlying Z2 symmetry, which would preclude odd powers of the scalar field phi appearing in our interactions. And in the case of these phi squared interactions, we have a very interesting situation in that we not only have the same types of oscillating phi signatures as we do on the top right here, we also have a number of additional signatures in this case, which give rise to a richer phenomenology in the case of phi squared couplings. So first of all, with phi squared couplings, we expect it to be changes or differences in the values of the fundamental constants, which are correlated with changes or differences in the dark matter density. Now, there are a number of ways in which these types of effects can arise. First of all, if we consider, for example, the expansion of the universe, then we expect it to be a dilution in the dark matter density as we go, for example, from the early period of the universe to the present day. And therefore, we expect it to be slow changes in the values of the fundamental constants, which would be correlated with changes in dark matter density over a long cosmological timescale. Another way in which these types of variations of fundamental constants can arise is if we have, for example, local fluctuations in the dark matter density over time. Then in this case, we would also expect it to be changes in the fundamental constants, which would be correlated with the changes in the local dark matter density. In addition to this, we also understand that there should be gradients in the dark matter density in the vicinity of massive bodies like Earth or the Sun. In this case, if we have phi squared interactions, we would therefore expect there to be additional equivalent principle violating forces which are directed along these dark matter density gradients, which are distinct from the equivalent principle violating forces that we had above here. There is another interesting difference between linear and quadratic interactions, which manifests itself in the vicinity of massive bodies, such as Earth. So if we look at a linear coupling, a linear phi interaction, in this case, we see that the classical equation of motion for the scalar field phi is the usual Klein-Gordon equation with the source term in pink here. So if we look at the scalar field profile, as that of a massive spherical body, we see that it consists as the sum of two terms. The first term on the left here is the oscillating time function, which corresponds to the oscillating dark matter component. And on the right here, we have the Yukawa type term in pink. And this essentially arises due to the exchange of a scalar boson between two bodies. So this is a relatively well-known linear superposition. But what is perhaps a little less well-known is what happens in the case of the quadratic and phi interactions. Now we see that with a phi squared interaction, because of the difference in the structure of the operators, in this case, if we look at the classical equation motion from the scalar field phi, we no longer have the source term in pink as we did before, but instead what we have is this effective mass term in orange. The role of this, so the role of this effective mass term in orange is essentially that in the presence of a non-zero density of ambient matter, the effective mass of this scalar field will be shifted away from its bare value in the vacuum. And the amount by which the mass or the effective mass is shifted by is going to be determined by the strength of the phi squared interaction, as well as by the local density of ordinary matter. And the role of this effective mass contribution is that if we now look at the scalar field profile as that of a spherical body, we see that we again have this oscillating time function. So this again corresponds to this oscillating dark matter component, except in this case, the amplitude of the oscillation phi naught is going to be multiplied by a factor which depends on the distance away from the center of this massive body. So depending on the sign of the phi squared interaction that we have in our model, we could in principle have either amplification or screening of the dark matter density in the vicinity of the massive body. So here we see that in this case, in the classical theory, there is no analogous Yukawa type term like the one in pink here. This can basically be understood by noting that with phi squared interactions, we cannot simply exchange a single boson between two bodies. And another way of thinking about this is that with a purely phi squared interaction, we don't have we don't have the usual analog of a classical source. However, what we can have in the case of phi squared interactions is we can simultaneously exchange a pair of bosons between two bodies. And this type of two boson exchange is an inherently quantum process because of the presence of the loop here. And this gives rise to a quantum correction to the scalar field profile as far as the spherical body. And the nature of this quantum correction is that this is a modified Yukawa type term, which falls off with a distance like 1 and r to the third power, which is a steeper fall off than the usual 1 and r fall off with the ordinary Yukawa types. As I mentioned in the previous slide, if there is relative motion between the apparatus and the dark matter halo, then there will be motional gradient terms associated with the cosinusoidal function for the dark matter component. And so we see that already in the simplest models of a scalar field with either a linear in phi interaction to ordinary matter or a quadratic in phi interaction to the ordinary matter fields, there can already be a number of different types of gradients which arise in the model. And we expect there to be equivalence principle providing forces directed along these gradients as a result of the interactions being non-universal in nature. There are a number of different ways that we could, in principle, look for equivalence principle violating forces. Traditionally, in terms of macroscopic tests of the equivalence principle that use, for example, Earth as the source body, this has generally been done best with so-called torsion pendula experiments or Cavendish-style experiments, and this has been the leading methodology for a little more than a century now. However, in recent years, there's also been another technique which has started to emerge as being quite competitive to these more traditional torsion pendulum experiments. And this has been in the form of interferometry-based experiments using cold atoms. In fact, these interferometry-based experiments have improved the sensitivity to tests of the weaker coolants principle using Earth as the source body by about five orders of magnitude over the past 10 years alone. So this has been a very rapid improvement on this front. So turning now to the subject of how we can look for these apparent oscillations in the values of the fundamental constants due to dark matter. Let's suppose we start at the lowest possible dark matter particle masses, where the period of oscillation is of the order of a month. In this case, one very powerful technique that we can use could involve atomic spectroscopy measurements or clock-based experiments. And this type of approach has actually been used for a number of decades now to look for possible slow drift or slow changes in the values of the fundamental constants. The basic idea is that if we have two atomic transitions between two different pairs of atomic energy levels, what we can do is measure the ratio of the two transition frequencies over time. And so if one or more of the fundamental constants of nature were to change over time, like the fine structure constant alpha or the electron to nuclear mass ratio, in this case, we'd expect it to be a slow change in the value of the ratio of these two transition frequencies over time. And the size of the change will be proportional to the difference in the sensitivities of these two transitions to changes in the fundamental constants of nature. So these sensitivity coefficients in red tell us basically the relative sensitivity of a transition to changes in the fundamental constants of nature. Now, we cannot experimentally measure these sensitivity, sensitivity coefficients, but what we can do is calculate them using ab initio atomic structure calculations. And we've been very fortunate to have had all of the coefficients calculated for existing atomic clocks and many of the coefficients calculated for future clocks, which are currently under development. And this has been largely courtesy of the work of Professor Victor Flambaum and co-workers in Sydney over more than the past 20 years now. So just to briefly explain where the sensitivity of these transitions to variations of the fundamental constants arises from. Let's suppose that we have an atomic optical transition. The archetypal transition frequency in this case can be decomposed as a product of two terms. The first term on the left here is the usual non-relativistic atomic unit of frequency. This is basically the Rydberg constant divided by Planck's constant. And this non-relativistic unit is common to all atomic transitions. So what this leaves us with in the case of optical transitions is this relativistic factor in blue. And this is a function of the product of the nuclear electric charge and the fine structure constant alpha. So if we measure the ratio of two atomic optical transition frequencies, what we see is that the non-relativistic atomic unit frequency would cancel the ratio here. And this would leave us with the ratio of the two relativistic factors in this case. Now, because these factors are relativistic in nature, what we see is that the size of the relative sensitivity coefficients to alpha variation will, generally speaking, tend to increase as we move towards atoms which are increasingly heavier. The basic reason for this is that in heavier atoms, the nucleus has a larger electric charge, and therefore the electron tends to orbit more quickly when it's closer to the nucleus. So because of the increased prevalence of relativistic effects in this case, we see that there's a general trend in terms of alpha sensitivity coefficients increasing. Now, of course, there can be more subtle effects involving the electronic structure, which can actually give significant deviations away from this trend. And it's actually possible to have very sizable enhancements in terms of these alpha sensitivity coefficients, although I won't go into this into any detail in this particular talk. We can also have atomic hyperfine transitions. So in this case, the archetypal hyperfine transition frequency is a little bit richer as compared with the atomic optical transition frequency. So first of all, we see that in the case of an atomic hyperfine transition frequency, there's an extra power of alpha squared as compared with the optical transition frequency. And the origin of this extra power of alpha squared is due to the short-range nature of the magnetic hyperfine interaction between the atomic electrons and the nucleus. This extra power of alpha squared gives rise to an extra factor of 2 for the relative alpha sensitivity coefficient when we look for the when we look at the hyperfine transitions as compared with the optical transitions above. However, just like the optical transitions, we see that as we move towards systems with a greater nuclear charge, we again tend to see an increase in the size of these relative sensitivity coefficients. Another interesting feature of atomic hyperfine transitions is that because of the presence of the because of the participation of the nuclear magnetic moments in the magnetic hyperfine interaction between the atomic electrons and the nucleus, there's also a sensitivity to variations of the electron to nuclear mass ratio here. And additionally, there also tends to be a non-zero, but generally speaking, quite small sensitivity to variations of the ratio of the light quark masses to the strong OQCD scale. So if we want to look for these oscillations in the values of the fundamental constants due to this oscillating dark matter field, the idea is very similar in terms of what has been done in previous searches for slow drifts in the fundamental constants, except now what we do is when we measure the ratio of the two transition frequencies over time, we basically just look for oscillations in the mean value of the transition frequency ratio in this case. The frequency of the signal that we would expect to see is expected to be governed by the mass of the dark matter particle. So in the case of linear phi interactions, this would be approximately given by the mass of the dark matter particle, whereas in the case of the quadratic interactions, the signal frequency would be doubled. So there have been a number of experimental searches performed using these types of clock comparison experiments. And this has mainly been done by groups at metrological institutes around the world, and about half a dozen different clock-clock combinations have already been utilized on this front. Now, if we want to consider searches for larger dark matter particle masses where the period of oscillation is much less than a month, in this case, it actually starts to become possible to use techniques and approaches which haven't traditionally been used in searches for variations of the fundamental constants. One of these ideas is based around the use of cavities. So if we consider a solid material, we know that the length of a solid scales proportionally to the atomic ball radius. Now, in this case, we see that if we define a reference frequency based on the length of the solid, then we would be sensitive to oscillations in the value of alpha and the fine structure, in the value of alpha and the electron mass. And this would be provided that the changes in these fundamental constants occur in an adiabatic rate. In other words, the solid length can only respond optimally to changes in the fundamental constants, provided that the sound wave propagation through the material can occur quickly enough on the scale of the on the time scale of the variations in the fundamental constants. Now we can reference a solid cavity frequency against, for example, an atomic transition frequency. If we consider an archetypal optical electronic transition, then in this case, in the non-relativistic limit, the transition frequency scales proportionally to the Rydberg constant. And so we see that there's an extra power of alpha as compared with the cavity-based frequency on the left here. So what this implies is that if we measure the ratio of the atomic transition frequency with respect to the solid cavity frequency, then we would be sensitive to oscillations in the value of the fine structure constant alpha in this case. And these types of atom to cavity comparisons have been implemented by a substantial number of groups around the world now. Some of these searches are actually already in their second iteration, and about half a dozen, about a dozen different clock cavity combinations have been used by the various groups. Now, it's not essential to compare a clock, it's not essential to compare a cavity against and atomic transition frequency, we can also go down a somewhat different path in which we keep the solid cavity from before, but now reference it against a different type of cavity, which consists of a pair of freely suspended mirrors. The basic idea in this case is that we can mount these mirrors on a double pendulum suspension systems, for example. The idea behind doing this is that when the dark matter frequency of oscillation lies above the natural frequencies of these mirror suspensions, the length of the second type of cavity would be unresponsive as far as the it would be essentially insensitive to the effects of the oscillating dark matter field. So another way of stating this is that the second type of cavity here would actually provide us with an excellent reference frequency, which would be basically insensitive to the effects of oscillations in the fundamental constants above the natural frequencies of the mirror suspensions. And as an added bonus, the second type of cavity would also be highly insensitive to common systematic effects, such as, for example, seismic noise, which would manifest at frequencies below the natural frequencies of the mirror suspensions. So if we reference these two different types of cavities, what we would be sensitive to in this case would be not only oscillations in the value of alpha, like we were in the case of the atom's solid cavity comparison from the previous slide. In this case, we would also actually be sensitive to apparent oscillations in the value of the electron mass. So the main take-home message here is that the manner in which we do these types of cavity to cavity, cavity to atom, or atom to atom comparisons is very important in terms of determining which physical parameters our experiments are going to be sensitive to. At the moment, there's actually a small-scale experiment currently under development by a group in the US to specifically do one of these cavity to cavity comparisons. Now, we can take this cavity-based idea and actually apply this to larger-scale detectors. For example, we can apply this idea to large-scale gravitational wave detectors, which operate on the principle of laser or optical interferometry. The simplest type of laser interferometer is based on so-called microconfiguration. Here, perhaps the best archetypal example would be the GS600 detector, which is a 600-meter detector located near Hanover, Germany. And the idea behind a microinterferometer is that we have essentially two arms here. So we want to measure changes in the difference of the optical path lengths in these two arms. And then what we search for would be changes in the interference pattern that we see at the outboard here. So if we, for example, consider that the dark matter affects the two arms in the same way, then in that particular situation, the effect of the dark matter would actually cancel at the outboard because this is a differential measurement. So what this suggests to us is that the effects of dark matter would tend to essentially manifest their, dark matter would essentially manifest, tend to manifest its effects by the intrinsic geometric asymmetries in the detector. In a Mach interferometer, the main source of geometric asymmetries tends to be in the central element, which is the beam splitter over here. And to see why this is the case, we can have a look at the zoomed in insert here to see that the main reflecting surface here is located on the top left edge over here. This is because the bottom right edge of the beam splitter is anti-reflective coated, which means that there are basically no reflections off the bottom right edge. So the main reflection point here is concentrated on the top left over here. And so if the thickness of the beam splitter were to oscillate over time, for example, due to this oscillating dark matter field, then at some moment in time, the main reflection surface would be shifted to the top left blue line over here. And so at this particular moment in time, our main reflection point will be shifted towards the left here. So if we go back to the original picture here, we see that at this moment in time, the length of the horizontal arm would be slightly elongated relative to the length of the vertical arm. Now, because the interferometer is measuring changes in the difference of the optical path length between these two arms, we would therefore be sensitive not only to oscillations in the thickness of the beam splitter, but would also be sensitive to oscillations in the refractive index of the base of the material. And following this idea, there have actually been two recent searches performed using older data sets to look for this particular type of signature. So this is first done by members of the Geophotonic Collaboration. This was recently published in Nature. And more recently, this was also done by a number of members of actually the Geophotonic and Fermilab Pyrometer experiments using data from the Fermilab Pyrometer. So the Fermilab Pyrometer is a smaller 40-meter interferometer in the US in this case, the results are reported here. So apart from the simple broadband approach, where we look for all the possible dark matter frequencies of oscillation at once in a bandwidth which is allowable by the experiment, there's also another type of approach that we can adopt, and that is we can perform a so-called resonant narrowband search. The basic idea in the latter case is that when the dark matter frequency of oscillation matches onto the vibrational frequency of the base splitter, that is the frequency of the longitudinal mode in this case, then when this resonance condition is satisfied, we can have a very sizable enhancement in the dark matter signal due to larger thickness oscillations in the mirror in this case. Now, the very large enhancement factor in this case is closely connected to the expected near monochromatic nature of the dark matter, of the oscillating dark matter field. And this is because galactic dark matter is expected, essentially observed, to be highly non-relativistic. And if we recall from earlier, the Pauli factor is expected to be about a million in our local galactic region. Now, the issue with the second type of approach is that we don't know what the dark matter particle mass is before we actually happen to find the actual dark matter candidate itself. So this implies that we need to have a method which is capable of scanning over a range of possible dark matter particle masses. And one of the simple ways in which we can do this is by incrementally changing the temperature of the system. If we change the temperature of the system, we of course change the thickness of the base splitter. And often more importantly, we would change the sound speed in the base splitter material. So by incrementally changing the temperature of the system, we scan over a range of possible dark matter frequencies of oscillation, which correspond to a certain range of dark matter particle masses. So this is how things work in the case of the simple microscope configuration. Now, the more modern gravitational wave detectors like LIGO, Virgo, and Kagra are based on a different type of interferometer, which is basically a fibroprobe microscope configuration. The idea in the latter case is that we add a pair of mirrors into the two arms of a microinterferometer here. And the addition of these two extra mirrors allows us to form these fibroprobe cavities where the light beam intensity gets amplified by a significant factor. Now, this boost in light beam intensity is fantastic if we're looking for ordinary gravitational waves, because if a transient gravitational wave were to pass through the detector, then it would affect, of course, all the space-time points between the ends of the mirrors here. And the higher light beam intensity in this case is beneficial in terms of boosting sensitivity to transient gravitational waves. However, this boost in the light beam intensity in the fibroprobe cavities is not necessarily an advantage in terms of searches for these oscillating dark matter fields. And the reason for this is that for a few hundred passages of the light beam between the ends of the fibroprobe cavity here, there is only one passage of the light beam through the base splitter here. So as far as the effects of the dark matter field via oscillations of the base splitter are concerned, the actual sensitivity of this second type of detector would be suppressed by a factor of a few hundred relative to the simple microscope interferometer. Now, we can overcome this disadvantage in one very simple way, and that is we can take one set of mirrors in either of the two arms here and change their thickness by a relatively modest amount of the order of 10% or so relative to the arm mirror thickness in the other arm. And when we do this, we can actually now have a situation where the dominant dark energy signal will now be due to oscillations in the arm mirror thickness mismatch in this case, as opposed to oscillations in the thickness of the beam splitter. So turning to some results, These are limits on the linear interaction of the scale dark matter field with the electromagnetic field. So down the bottom left here, we have the clock comparison limits shown in blue. And then we also have the clock cavity comparison limits in red here. So both the limits in blue and red, both come about from searching for apparent oscillations in the value of the fine structure constant alpha due to this oscillating dark matter field. So on the x-axis here, we see that we have the logarithm of the dark matter particle mass. And so higher frequencies of oscillation go to the right in this case. On the y-axis here, we have the dark matter interaction parameter, which is the new physics energy scale here. And feeble interactions in this case go down the page. So what we see is that the limits in blue and red collectively give us up to about four orders of magnitude improvement of the complementary bounds from the experiments in green and yellow. So the experiments in green and yellow are torsion pendular experiments, which search for equivalence principle violating forces, which are mediated by the exchange of a virtual scalar boson between a source body and the test masses in these experiments. So the experiments in yellow and green do not explicitly search for dark matter in this regard. Nevertheless, if we move towards the somewhat larger dark matter particle masses, which correspond to the audio frequency band in this case. In this case, the most impressive limits from optical interferometry experiments at the moment come from Jesus kind of experiments, and these are shown in cyan in this case. I should also, of course, mention that if we consider different types of interactions, such as the interaction of the scale dark matter field with the electron, then in that case, the fifth force bounds in yellow and green weakened by about a factor of 20, whereas the curve in light blue remains where it is. And so in that particular case, the interpretation actually becomes more favorable for the optical interferometry experiments. On this graph here to the right, we also see the position of the Planck scale as marked by the purple line. And so what this is telling us is that over this broad range of dark matter particle masses, which we have in this graph here, the scalar boson masses, in this case, the new physics energy scales which have already been probed and excluded all happen to lie above the Planck scale in this case, which is another way of saying that the interactions already probed are intrinsically feeble in gravity. If we look at the quadratic interaction of the scale dark matter field with the electromagnetic field, the picture is qualitatively quite different. So the first difference that we see here is that the Planck scale, which now is down the bottom left here, is shown again by the purple line. And what this means is that, unlike the previous example where the new physics energy scale was constrained to be above the Planck scale for the whole range of scalar boson masses, in this case, the new physics energy scale can actually be below the Planck scale in this case, and in some cases by a significant margin. So down the bottom left of this graph, we see that we have the clock comparison limits in blue. These come about from searching for oscillations in the value of the fine structure constant as a result of the oscillating dark matter field. If we move to the right here, we see that we have the astrophysical bounds, which are associated with big band nuclear synthesis measurements and calculations. That is, we're basically comparing predictions for the observed light primordial elemental abundances, which were produced in the first few minutes of the universe. In this case, we're basically considering the effect of a slow change in the value of the fine structure constant going from the earliest moments of the universe to the present day. So basically what we see is that the limits in blue and red collectively give us up to 15 orders of magnitude improvement over the previous laboratory and astrophysical bounds in purple and gray. In the middle of the graph, we also see these interesting regions in yellow and green here. So these are also torsion pendular experiments like the previous slide. However, the difference compared with the previous slide is that in this case, these types of experiments were now interpreted in terms of searches for equivalence principle violating forces, which are directed along gradients in the dark matter density around Earth. And this is different as compared with the equivalence principle violating forces on the previous page, which were due to the exchange of a virtual scalar boson between two bodies. Now, the difference between the experiments in yellow and green here is that the experiment in yellow is a laboratory experiment, which is performed close to Earth's surface. On the other hand, the experiment in green here is a space-based experiment done at an altitude of about 700 kilometers. And this was a microscope mission of the French Space Agency. So the interesting observation here is that as we move towards somewhat larger dark matter particle masses, where the interaction strength is somewhat stronger, in this particular case, we actually have an interesting situation where in this model of a scalar dark matter field with a fast current interaction, the dark matter density can actually become strongly screened when we're close to Earth's surface. So the main take home message here is that by positioning the apparatus or an apparatus sufficiently far away from Earth's surface can give us a sizable advantage over how this experiment performed essentially on the ground or close to Earth's surface. So to summarize and conclude, I've given a very brief overview of some of the precision low-G experiments, which can give us very powerful probes of these ultra-low mass scale dark matter fields. And the effect which I focused on in this talk essentially concerns apparent variations in the so-called fundamental constants of nature. And by taking advantage of these new types of signatures, we, and in some cases, a number of other groups around the world, have been able to improve the sensitivity to the underlying interaction strengths between these low mass scalar dark matter fields and ordinary matter fields, anywhere by up to 15 orders of magnitude. And this very sizable improvement in terms of sensitivity has been largely thanks to a number of novel ideas and approaches based on a number of precision low-G experiments. And one of the aspects I would like to emphasize here is that these experiments can often be done on a tabletop scale, which means that they are relatively compact and relatively low cost. And so some of the ideas which I discussed in this talk, atomic spectroscopy and clock-based measurements have been used quite successfully already. Optical cavities and interferometers have also been useful. And in the case of accelerometers, we also have some interesting limits from torsion pendulum experiments. And in the near future, perhaps also we'll have further valuable information from atom interferometry experiments as well. So on that note, I'd like to conclude and would like to thank you very much for your attention.
Great. Thank you very much, Yevgeny. Fascinating talk. Please, anyone have any questions they want to ask? Just go ahead.
Yeah, can I start?
Yeah.
That was a quick question. Thank you very much for a very nice talk, Yevgeny, very informative. I had a question about this, the forces which are induced, or it may be a very naive question, actually. Induced by this dark matter scalar, light scalars, the exchange of the light scalars. Now, the thing what you computed there, she showed, for example, this quantum, so-called quantum force with a double exchange of phi, for example. Mm-hmm. It scales as a 1 over r cubed with an exponent. But my concern here is that if we are, thinking about this phi as a dark matter, surely the exchange that doesn't happen in vacuum. So you may have, for example, the diagram where one of these legs are actually in the ambient space, and maybe that will change r dependent for the force.
Well, or no? I understand what you're saying. Basically, have one leg here and one coupled externally. Yeah. Of course, that is basically I believe this type of effect. Because one of the bosons communicates with the local density, and that can induce a deformation in the dark matter field. And this indeed, in the as far as the dark matter field amplitude is concerned, that falls off like one on r, similarly to like a Yukawa type force, Yukawa type term in the for virtual particle exchange.
It depends also on the density of dark matters, I would assume, right, in that case.
I don't think it comes out anywhere else like that. But we always have to have, of course, we always need to have two scalars entering into the process. So we could have, for example, two scalars entering into a leg. Yeah, they have to come at the same point. That type of correction probably would be smaller. But there would be, yes, you're right, a density dependent effect in that case, but I think it's subleading.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
Anyone else? Mikhail? Or Roland?
Well, I could ask another very naive question. I didn't quite understand with the parameter space exclusion plots that you were showing towards the end. Are you probing into a region, where these bosons can be the dark matter? I mean, how, or is it by construction that you're requiring that they are all of the dark matter?
In principle, I think with vacuumous alignments, they can be produced for these particular ranges of parameters. Whether or not the sort of ranges are parameter space is natural or not, that's I guess that depends more on the sort of possible quantum corrections to the scalar mass. That's a separate issue.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe I can ask quickly. So you showed this comparison on the quadratic interaction where you had the microscope experiment outperforming the Erdwash because of this screening. Do you have a model where it's like the other way around because you have the amplification because of this plus or minus that you were showing in the other four slide?
Oh yeah, that's right. So this is this slide here is for one particular value of the sign. One particular choice of sign. Indeed, if we were to flip the sign of the bi-square interaction, we would indeed have amplification. So in this paper here, I think it's like one of the later figures, figure three or figure four, we do actually give limits on this, on the opposite sign as well. However, there we run into an issue for significantly strong interactions because when we actually have a very large enhancement in dark matter field amplitude, we run into issues of non-perturbativity entering into the problem. So in that case, a simple, say, phi squared interaction by itself is probably insufficient to get, for example, a self-consistent interpretation of the experiment. We'd have to add additional terms or higher order terms to interpret in that kind of very strongly coupled region. But we do have a figure showing essentially where that cutoff occurs as well. Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. Anyone else? We haven't had any student questions today, so nobody's going in for the prize.
Don't be shy.
Michael?
Yeah. Okay. Maybe I can ask one quick question, not a student question. So simple question. So that quadratic coupling there, that's non-renormalizable, right? Did you think about how you would generate it in the model or some underlying theory which would generate these type of interactions?
No, I'm not entirely sure. Although in the case of a linear interaction, I guess if we have a phi to the electromagnetic field by itself, it's also non-renormalizable, but we can generate that radiatively through the linear coupling to the electron field, I guess. But I'm not entirely sure of how much model building has been done with bi-square interactions. I think some people have toyed with the idea of introducing a Z2 symmetry. There may be some papers on that, but I don't know the details of how it would arise. In the standard model, we don't have, of course, a Z2 symmetry like that.
Oh, of course. Well, you can always introduce it. There's nothing.
Yeah.
Really wrong with it. Yeah, thanks.
Okay, if there's no other questions, I might ask one very, well, I think it's a quick one. Why was there then no BBN bound for the linear photon coupling?
Let me try to go back here. There is a bound. We actually derived a bound in this paper here. Essentially, If we look at, say, the five square coupling first of all here, we see that there's this sort of kink for changing in the gradient around about, I think, minus 16 eV as a mass. The point is that on these relatively, during these early times of the universe, of course, when the mass of the scalar field was comparable to or less than the Hubble parameter, the field was essentially frozen or stuck due to Hubble friction. So in this case, we see one particular type of dependence when the scalar field was oscillating essentially the whole time, and we see a different dependence when the scalar field was essentially frozen. In the case of linear phi interactions, we did actually derive a bound for the linear interaction in the case of this sort of frozen regime. From memory, it's around about the Planck scale here and it falls off like this. So it was a weaker bound. And then presumably it would have to fall off even faster at higher masses because with a linear phi interaction, when the field starts to oscillate, because it's a phi, the expectation value of phi is, well, basically zero up to a fraction of an oscillation. So there'd be additional sort of fall off at the higher masses. Whereas in the case of a phi squared interaction, the sort of average value of phi squared, even for an oscillating field, is going to be, well, basically phi naught squared divided by two, because its cosine squared can be decomposed into a constant piece and a rapidly oscillating piece, which doesn't change sign. So there is a limit on the linear interaction with BBM. We give it in this paper, but it's relatively mild.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So I don't see any other people unmuting themselves. So maybe I can end the recording.